because I had forgotten to familiarize myself with them too much. But let's see. I guess first of all, thank you very much. It looks really good.
It does.
Yeah, I couldn't really understand what I was looking at. So,
which ones do you have trouble with?
Well, let's start with the. Where is it? Okay, now the whole shape that you drew. It's an elevation looking at the bow.
I only have two here, both from the stern, one with pilot house and one without.
Okay, the one with the pilot house. I thought it was from the forward, but it may be from the stern. All the lines are transparent, so it runs together. The whole, and I guess this is not really that important, but the whole shape towards the bow. I guess as long as I follow the general idea, I'm good. The angles towards the bottom are a little bit too acute. Is it okay if I just kind of smooth those out as I actually build?
Yeah. No problem at all.
Okay. Great.
And that's kind of modifications that you can make quite easily.
Right. No. I knew that, you know, it's kind of hard to make a good curve using these programs, but I wanted to make sure that was something that I could do pretty easily. Also, yeah. I couldn't really tell, but in the drawing that I did, my what I call the upper chime, you know, as the shear comes down and it's the first chime. That I drew that rising up as it went towards the front, a little bit less in yours, but I guess that really doesn't affect things too much, would it?
No. Okay. I'm opening the model now rather than the pictures that I sent you. Did I send you a 3D DXF file?
Yeah, you did. I don't have a program that runs 3D.
Well, if you go to the website of Autodesk, you can download a free piece of software. I think that is called Autodesk Viewer or AutoCAD Viewer.
I've been seeing them. I can do that. But the only thing is, it doesn't do me any good because what I'm going to do is basically take the lines that you've drawn and put them into my program, into the drawing I'm doing, because my goal is to basically take these frames and create a pattern for each one so that, you know, I can cut them out.
Yeah.
Pretty simply. So the 3D stuff makes it look nice, but I don't really. You know, I don't really need that. I guess it would be good to do the displacement, but I guess that's the next question.
What I always find helpful myself is that you just rotate the model on your screen and look at it from every possible angle, and then you get a much better idea if you like the shape or not.
Okay. Okay. Yes, I'll have to download the AutoCAD viewer to do that. I guess, okay, well, that's fine with that one. The next one is, okay, I see where you did the hull in the plan view.
Sorry, let's go back to the 3D model.
Okay, yeah, well, actually, I can view the 3D model in the email. Pretty good.
Okay.
Okay.
Do you like to see more volume up front and the chine rise a bit?
No. The way it looks here, it looks fine in the 3D model. That actually looks pretty good. It was. It really doesn't matter. As long as I maintain, I assume, the general dimensions, I may add a little flare here or there, but I won't change anything to increase or decrease the volume or shape of the hole. What I did notice, and maybe this was my calculations, but I think the top of the hull towards the aft was a different dimension, but I can double check that. Again, when I first opened the drawing, I had it gave me options if I wanted the units to be inches or meters or feet. And I think the first one I chose was inches. And when I went to measure it, I think I got some kind of crazy number. But since then, I've had a better understanding. And I bought a new computer since we last spoke. So I've been trying to get new software for this computer that's not too expensive. Because I thought they would let me transfer my license for the Autodesk program I use, but they wouldn't let me transfer it. They said I had to buy new software, and you know, it's not too expensive, but I didn't want to spend the money right now.
No,
the 3D model looks great. Looks great. Yeah, it looks fine. I mean, that looks great. It looks pretty good at the front and towards the stern.
When I was modeling the pilot house, I ran into what was that again? It's with the raised part, the aft end. That didn't correspond in two of the views that you had drawn. So I made my own interpretation of it, which is basically what you see on the 3D model now.
Okay, yeah, that looks good. I keep going back and forth with whether or not the doghouse will be at a direct vertical when it reaches the pilot house, or if it'll be at an angle. I go back and forth with that all the time, how I'm going to do that. But, you know, that still, again, shouldn't change anything. Now, let me ask this question. In your email, you said something about the stability. So if we go to the stability curve, I guess that's the big one that could use the explanation about. Exactly what does that mean?
Have you ever seen curves like that?
I have seen it. And I understand what the curve means, but how does my broke present itself on this curve?
Awesome.
Okay. I like that word, awesome. That's a good word. I like that word. So let's look at it. Let's explain it to me. So if we
do you remember what I explained to you about a fairly narrow cabin with a lot of volume?
You said, yeah, a fairly narrow cabin with a lot of volume means that the boat pretty much won't stay upside down.
Yes, and that is exactly what you see in the curve.
Okay.
You have no negative stability.
Now, where is that portrayed in this curve?
You see, which one are you looking at?
I'm looking at where it says stability up at the upper right-hand corner, and it starts off at zero, and at 20 degrees, it looks like I'm at a 5 point something.
Yeah.
At 40, I'm at what looks like almost a 9. So what do those represent? That 5 and that. What does the y axis represent on the left hand side?
I'm gonna quickly look up a picture here on the internet and I'll email that to you. Hang on for a second.
Okay.
Something here. You should have it now.
It's opening now.
Okay.
Okay, you sent me three things. Which one do you want me to start with?
Just one, I said.
Okay, I'll stick with the last one. It's just a bit of a...
Sorry. The other email was saying that I was preparing for the conversation.
Okay.
Okay, and so... That was a little bit late.
The cruising.com curves?
Yes. Now, if you scroll down to the first picture, you see two boats side by side, one upright and one a little bit heeled. You see those?
Yeah, it's.
And then you see a G and a B.
Right, the gravity and the center of buoyancy, right.
Exactly.
Right, okay.
Now, if you heel the boat over, there is a distance between the two.
Ah, okay.
That is called the horizontal distance. That is called the GZ.
Okay.
And that is basically the curve that you see here, because that distance is different for every heel angle.
Okay.
And the curve that you're looking at is basically the GZ curve.
Okay. So and when you say Z, that's European for Z, right?
Yes, it is. And Canadian as well.
Okay, gotcha now. All right, I'm understanding. So those values represented there is on the graph that I'm seeing here, is that a percentage or is it a distance? Is it a meter? Is it a foot?
It's a distance.
And
for some reason, the curve was spit out in meters.
Okay.
Whereas I made a model in imperial dimensions, so I'm not sure why that happened.
Okay.
But I can change that if you like.
Well, no, I don't want you to redo work because...
No, it's no big deal.
Okay, that's fine. I just wanted to understand what these things meant. Okay, so at the apex of the curve, we're at 60 degrees around about, maybe 64 degrees, and the distance there is 1.4 meters?
Yeah.
Okay.
That is basically the maximum stability arm.
Okay.
I'm assuming you're familiar with moments.
Yeah, I am.
Mm-hmm. Force and a distance.
Right.
So basically what that says is that the maximum riding moment of your boat is that distance multiplied by the weight of your boat.
Okay.
And that determines how much sail you can carry.
Okay. So with...
Now, mind you that for the center of gravity, for the height of it, which... plays a fairly important role in this curve, I had to make some assumptions.
Okay. And what are those?
Basically, with most sailing yachts, the center of gravity is laying somewhere around the waterline. For this graph, I placed it slightly higher because that is a more conservative approach.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Since I do not know exactly where it is.
Yeah. Right, it's got a lot of volume to it, plus the powerhouse, so I guess that would be a reasonable assumption. So with that assumption, it still performed pretty well.
It performs very well, okay. And that is mainly due to the volume of your canatop.
Okay, now what about the amount of sail area that I'm able to carry? How does that top number influence that?
This curve shows how much resistance the boat has against heeling over.
Okay.
And, well, let's take for example the 20 degree heeling angle. You have a riding arm, GC, which is 0.56, 0.57, somewhere thereabouts.
Okay.
And you multiply that by the weight of the boat. That gives you a riding moment. Now, the pressure in your sail has a center of effort, and if you divide your riding moment by the height of where that center of effort is, that basically says how much pressure you can have in your sail. You follow what I'm saying?
I do. So 0.56 times 36,000 pounds.
Yes.
There's a lot of damn pressure.
Exactly.
Good lord.
Okay. Exactly.
And that's at a 20 degree angle, huh?
Yeah, but constant heel angle is much more than that. You probably will never see.
Right, no, that's good. I just was recalling you said that a sailboat should be pretty stable at a 30 degree angle of heel. So we don't use that for calculated sail area, though.
No, not really. Usually I don't go further than 20.
Okay.
Wow. Okay. Usually with boats like yours, but like mine as well, if you hit the 20 degree heeling angle when sailing upwind, then you start to get the rudder pressure and put it even your sail, and it sails as fast and much more comfortable.
Okay.
You hit the hull speed and faster than that you can go anyway.
Right, gotcha. So if I'm using the old fashioned chart, the what's it called? The chart that gives you wind pressures at a certain wind speed. The force 10, force 1.
Okay, yeah.
What's the name of the chart again?
Beaufort scale?
Yeah, right. So if we're saying at a force 5, which is 19 to 24, the pressure is roughly, I'm going to round it up to about 2 pounds a square foot.
Yes.
Right. So, 2 pounds a square foot. If I've got 1,200 square foot out, that means I'm at about 2,400 pounds of pressure. And you're saying that I can have 20,000 pounds of pressure?
Well, that depends on how high the center of effort is.
Right, okay. I gotcha.
Let me do a rough estimate here.
The Beaufort scale, that's what they call it. Beaufort scale.
Yeah.
I'm looking right at it, but I forgot the name of it.
Going back to your old emails for the sail plan. Yeah, that basically means that close to wind force 5, you can sail with 1,200 square feet.
Okay. Oh, okay. Yeah, that's about where, that's fine. So at 20 knots, I can have full sail out.
Pretty much, yeah.
Okay. I think we'll be doing pretty good if that happens. All right. That's excellent. That's great news.
Now, one thing that you might want to do is detail your weight calculation a bit further.
Okay.
So that you have an exact height of your center of gravity.
Okay.
If you can give me that number, I can double check.
Now,
if that makes a lot of difference or not.
What do you use to calculate that? Because what I did is I simply took the weight of all the lumber, all the material, and just did rough geometry to figure that out. Then I added the weight of the tanks and all of the engine and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
Is there another formula that you guys use to figure that out?
What you basically do is from all those individual parts that you have the weight of,
mm-hmm.
you look for every part, how high the center is related to the waterline.
Okay.
You multiply the height times the weight of that component.
Right.
You do that for every part that is on your weight calculation. You add that all up at the end, and you divide that by the weight, the total weight of your boat.
Okay.
And that gives you the height of the center of gravity of the boat itself.
Okay. So
it is a bit of work.
Yeah, I see, because I'm thinking about the frame, and the frame, if it's monolithic in dimension, you know, mm-hmm. then that's easy enough. That would be this, you know, basically the center of the vertical height, so to speak. But then once you add the weight of the floors, and the sole,
mm-hmm.
and the actual, like I said again, the engine and all the tanks, and then the seating, all those components are also down lower. So that will take a bit of work, but
it is quite a bit of work, yes, yeah. And it is not fun work to do, but it is important.
Okay. So once we figure that out, what does that give us? What does that tell us? Exactly how much sail area we can handle.
That too. There is also official criteria that if you would build this boat commercially, that a boat has to comply with.
Okay.
So to make a judgment if it is a safe boat or not. Sorry?
No, I was saying I understand it, what you're saying.
Yeah, just to judge if it's a safe boat or not, you would compare it to those regulations. And you don't have to comply anything because you build the boat for yourself.
So, but the initial stability is different than what the ballast would be. I mean, would that just be an issue of increasing ballast if the center of gravity is higher?
Yeah, to some extent that will work.
Okay.
If it is way and way off, which I don't think, because this is looking very good.
Right, because essentially the boat is the regular boat, except it's just has more headroom in it, so it's like I'm stretching
exactly.
the shear another foot so I won't hit my head on anything.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. Okay. Okay, that's good to know. And you know, initially I was doing some things more conventional in terms of frames that I could downsize. Let me ask you this question now. The frames for this boat will be three inches, right? So okay. I will have a 3/4 inch sheeting, right? Plywood mm-hmm. on the outside. I have a 3 inch frame, and then I'll have probably a half of an inch plywood on the inside to make the interior finish, whatever that would be.
Yeah.
Now, what I was going to do is inside that cavity, I was going to put 2 inch insulation.
Mm-hmm.
That would, one, help with buoyancy, and two, help to insulate the boat. Have you seen that done? Or do people do that a lot?
They do.
Okay.
Except that they would build a boat and just have the cavity foamed up.
Now, see, I didn't want to do that because I heard that if you put the foam right on the plywood, it kind of helps the plywood to rot. So I was going to leave an air gap between the exterior surface and the insulation.
That would be a good idea if you can ventilate there.
Yeah, yeah. That my goal was to have it so that the air could circulate from the bilge upwards to vents that would, you know, be somewhere above to keep that air circulating in there. Because, you know, it's just an idea.
Yeah.
Because like
if you can ventilate it, then it's a good idea. If you can't, then just completely fill it up.
Okay. Okay. What's your thoughts on insulation spray on right over top of frames or right over top of plywood?
That's what I have on my boat.
I thought your boat was metal.
Yeah, it is. But there's also plywood in there.
Is it? Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So do you have an R rating on your boat?
Not that I know. But of course, there is an R rating, but I don't know what it is.
Okay.
But I have about 4 inches of foam pretty much all around.
Wow. Wow. Okay, great. Great.
But I use my boat in the Arctic, so I like to have it warm inside.
Yeah, like I said, I'll never be sailing with you though. Okay. Yeah. So the stability curve looks good.
Yes.
Okay, great, 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 great. Let's see. Let me go back.
That is one less thing to worry about.
Okay. Good. So then let me look at these other drawings that you've given. Now, you sent me a spreadsheet that said hydrostatics.
Mm-hmm.
Can we talk about that?
Let me see what I sent you. Do you have it handy there?
Do I have what?
Do you have that sheet handy there? Can you email it to me?
Mm-hmm. It's handy, yeah. Let me.
Because I'm behind a different computer now.
Okay. I'll send
from what I made it on.
Send it right to you. Can I send it right to you? Should be able to send it right to you. It's an Excel spreadsheet.
There's no attachments. Is there?
I'll try it again. Okay, I sent it again.
Yes, there it is. So, what about that one?
Okay. So, you have the volume here, but you didn't list it a displacement.
Yes, that is something that the software does automatically because it didn't specify the mass of the water. Because in fresh water, that would be slightly different from what it is in seawater.
Okay, so I'm multiplying that times 64.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, good. Okay, so that's right where I need it to be.
So that's about 36,800 pounds.
Right. Okay. So when I initially load my boat, it's going to ride high.
Sorry, say that again.
When I initially load the boat, or when I actually build the boat,
yeah,
it's going to ride high. It's going to float high because that 36,008 mark is my fully tanked out sort of. Number.
Yeah.
Is that a problem?
No, not at all.
Okay. All right. Okay. Good. Draft amidships, that was a zero. The second, the third number, the third line?
Yeah. That is basically your maximum draft.
Okay.
But what I think is that I did not define where amidships is in the model. That's why it's on zero. And your immersed depth is 5 feet 6 inches.
Right, right, right.
And that's basically your maximum draft as well.
And so the beam max extensions on waterline, I thought we reduced that to. Like 14 feet. It's 12 foot 7?
That is the maximum beam on the waterline itself. And I think what you're thinking of is maximum beam of the boat. What you see here is just from the underwater part.
Right. No, I remember. Okay, I got you. Right, I remember now. We
it is on the waterline, it's slightly narrower than
right,
on the deck.
Right, that's where the lower chine is, okay. Because I know we had 16 foot at the deck. Then we came down. Initially, it was only a 6-inch taper, but then you doubled that to 6 inches on both sides. So at that upper shear, that was 15 feet. So then from there, I'm sorry, from the upper chine, it was 15 feet. So from there down to the waterline, it's okay, I got you. Okay, I'm understanding that.
Okay.
All right. The wetted area. Does that have the reduced keel?
That is the keel as it is in the 3D model.
Which is a full keel, right?
Which is, then that's the reduced one.
That's the reduced one. Okay.
Yeah. So that's basically the amount of antifouling paint that you have to smudge on.
Right. Okay. All right. Okay. Now, what is this other max section?
Yeah, that's the maximum sectional area. That is basically the area of your largest frame, the submerged area of your largest frame.
Okay, gotcha.
Which is a value that is used for resistance calculations.
Okay. Ah, okay.
But for you, it's not that important to know. I mean, nobody knows this about his own boat.
Okay.
Except for the designer.
Right. So, do I need a centerboard, or do you think I can do without the centerboard?
I think you can get away without. But I haven't really looked that close in detail to the how the keel would react.
Okay. That'll be, the next thing that I'll pay you for to kind of start working on my sail area and I guess underwater resistance and all those kinds of things. So that's cool. We can figure that out in the next. I can start building now and we can figure the rest out. Right. Okay.
Yeah.
What's this is my parasmatic coefficient. Okay. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean I have a fat hull?
That basically means that you have relative large volume in the ends.
Okay.
And in your case, that is mainly in the stern of the boat because the bow is quite sharp.
Right, okay.
And that is mainly caused by the hull going basically horizontal and then goes up quite steep to the stern.
Right.
But this is not about that value to have, not
okay.
at all.
Okay.
Now, if you had that in combination with a lot of volume up front, then I would advise you to skin it out a bit.
Okay.
And that is basically the main benefit of lengthening the hull, what we talked about earlier.
Okay, gotcha.
Because with the same weight, you make the boat skinnier if you make it longer.
Okay, now this answers, you have 65 stations in here, so that means in the model I'm looking at, you've got 65 different frames?
Yeah, that is the precision of the calculation. So basically what the computer program does is chop the model up in 65 stations.
Okay.
The higher that number, the higher the precision, but also the longer the computing power is. And I use usually 10% more stations than the length of the boat. So you have a 57 foot. Was it 57 foot?
It's 54.
Yeah, I use slightly more here. Higher precision does give you a little bit more precision in the calculation, but for what we're doing here, this is close enough. That has absolutely nothing to do with the amount of building stations that you would have.
Right.
So it has nothing to do with framing.
Right. So if I needed you to send me that with the exact amount of stations that I'm building with, is that something you could easily do?
Yeah, that is just a few minutes of work.
Okay.
So you tell me which frames you want and on what distances, and I have the computers spit out the shapes for you.
Okay, so I can start at the bow and work my way back?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll do that then.
If you,
okay.
So if you can put that in an AutoCAD drawing, make clear what your point of reference is, where you measure from, which I think the stem is the easiest to do from.
Right.
Yeah, and then work your way back.
Okay.
And whenever down the line you want that changed, it's no big deal to do.
Okay. All right. Well, I think that's pretty much it, my man. I just wanted to really understand what these numbers and pieces of information were. Glad to know my boat doesn't have any stability upside down.
Well, you're one of the very few in the world. That's something to be proud of.
Then I don't plan to ever go upside down, so let's hope we
don't. No, but you never know.
We don't need to. Yeah, for real. Definitely.
Just make sure that your windows are strong enough to take it.
Yeah. I mean, some definitely thick Lexan. Only thing about Lexan, it just scratches up. And glass is just so expensive and so heavy.
And it's very heavy, yeah.
Yeah. What do you have on your boat?
I have glass, but I have very small windows.
Oh, okay.
My portholes are about the size of my computer screen. Maximum.
Yeah, because there's be nobody else sailing where you're sailing. That's so damn cold. All right. Well, that's great.
If you ever have any additional questions, or when we hang up and you say, I forgot to ask that, feel free to shoot me an email.
Well, no, what I'm going to do, I'm going to go through your laundry list that you sent the first time. And,
okay.
I guess send another deposit through the PayPal.
Okay.
Does that still work?
Yeah, okay. No problem.
We'll do that and kind of figure the next couple things that I would like for you to kind of work on for me. I know the sale plan's important. And the windward performance is also something that I'd like to kind of get down. I think when we spoke last, you said I shouldn't really have a problem, making 10 or 12 knots. And I just wanted to make sure that's still the way you feel after finishing this hull stability. What are you thinking?
Well, 10 knots would be about the maximum for a 54-foot boat.
Okay.
Given the weight and the amount of stability that you have, it should be quite easy to reach that, especially running with the wind.
Good. And beating? That depends on what.
Just from a gut feeling. Also depends on the quality of the sails that you put on her, of course.
Okay.
7 knots shouldn't be a problem to have as continuous speed.
So we're talking in between 120 degrees.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I assume the best point of sail for most boats would be like 120 to 150?
Yeah. That's about right. Well, there's boats that perform slightly better at 70, 80, but those are usually the higher end racing boats. But for boats like yours and like mine, but 130 degrees.
Okay, so slightly behind the beam. No.
Yeah. That is what these boats like.
Okay. All right. Cool. Well, I guess that's it for now. All right.
Okay. And as I said, if you ever have questions, feel free to email me.
I'll have plenty of questions. Believe that. I'm going to Are you still up with Andy's website, with his blog, with his
Oh, I've never done anything with him. He just interviewed me a couple of times.
Okay, no, he interviewed me a couple of weeks ago too, and we were talking about how he introduced me to you, and
okay.
we were talking about the PBO versus the Dyneema.
Okay.
He says he's going to have to talk to you about that. for that rigging. He's a big proponent of that. But yeah. Okay. Well, I appreciate that very much.
No problems at all. Sorry that it took a bit long.
Oh, no problem. It's holiday time. I know everybody's busy. You were right up the street from me. I mean, New Jersey's only an hour, maybe 2 hours away.
Really?
What part of New Jersey were you in?
What's it called? The East.
East Brunswick?
No, East. God.
Was it near New York City?
Yeah, it was about a 20-minute ride by bus.
Okay, yeah, you were pretty close to New York, and that's further north. That's closer to 3 hours away then.
In New Jersey, you have the train stations, the railway stations that have the east, north, south, and west. And they all have the same name. What was that again? East.
I'm thinking you were probably in East Brunswick or something like that.
No, that was not Brunswick. Oh, I want to know now. I'm going to pull up Google Maps.
East Orange?
Yes, East Orange. That's where I was.
Okay. Yeah, that's the city, man. That's a densely populated area. I have some good friends who live in that area.
Yeah, my cousins live there.
And a place called Montclair, which is not too far from there.
Do you know the big golf court there?
No, I haven't been up there in years. That's an expensive place to live, buddy.
Yes, it is.
It's almost expensive as New York City.
Yeah. But they basically live right beside the main golf court that is there.
Okay, well, you didn't play golf, did you? It was too cold, wasn't it?
No, I didn't.
When's the next time you go on sale?
Maybe in a few weeks.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but it's just a short trip.
In Bagheera?
Yeah.
Well, better you than I. How things going with the Adventure 40?
A bit slow at the moment. I did get a lot of engineering work done over the holidays, but during the holidays I was quite surprised that I had difficulties finding decent internet access. That's also why I didn't talk to you. But I did a lot of engineering, and this is confidential, by the way.
Okay, well, hold on a second. We need to stop recording. Hold on, let me figure this thing out. How do I do this? Let's see. Stop.